writing the Proslogion and in trying to concoct something like a rigorous proof for God's existence, Anselm is faced with a problem that he's going to face in this room too. No matter how rigorous this proof, it's not really going to sway many people. It's not going to make people who don't believe in God, and it's not probably even going to convince too many believers that this is the reason you should believe in God. Because at least in modern Christianity, say, and I think probably the same is true to one degree or another in most of the modern Western religions anyway, and that includes Judaism and Islam, belief in God is not supposed to be some sort of narrowly intellectual or cognitive thing. It's supposed to come from the heart. That your belief is supposed to not be just some philosophical proof. It's not supposed to be based on some philosophical proof. So Anselm is producing what I think is something awfully like a philosophical proof. In chapter one of the Proslogion, he's trying to tell people, don't worry about that. Like, that's not, you know, this, I think in chapter one he's saying, this proof, and I'm going to give you this handout, I'm going to wave this around for a second here, because this is the proof. This proof isn't supposed to be the reason why one believes in God. One's supposed to believe in God through revelation, through faith. But the atheists out there, this is true 1,000 years ago when Anselm was writing this roughly, as much as it is today. The atheists out there, they keep saying that belief in God is in conflict with reason. The atheists seem to think that that belief in God is incompatible with reason and that reason is on their side. What I'm going to show them, mainly, is that it's just the opposite. The shoe is on the other foot. Reason is absolutely in conflict with disbelief. Reason not only is on the side of belief in God, reason makes it necessary to believe in God. Now again, that's not exactly the reason why anybody should believe in God, but this is going to diffuse the atheist's argument. And it's going to prepare the ground for the right reasons for belief, namely faith, revelation, and all that stuff. So I think that's sort of what Anselm is trying to do in that first chapter. I am not sure whether he was the Archbishop of Canterbury when he wrote this particular piece. I don't remember that detail, but he was at one time in his life, either before or after writing this piece, I would presume, if not while he wrote this piece, then later, he was the Archbishop of Canterbury. He was the Archbishop of Canterbury when the English Church was still Roman Catholic. They haven't made that break yet. Later on, there was a great break with Rome, and the Church of England was established in its place. But at this time, it was still Roman Catholic. And so what Anselm is trying to do is to prepare a proof that will undermine his opponent's arguments, mostly. And in chapter one, he's basically saying to his fellow believers, don't worry, just because I'm spending a lot of time with this philosophical proof here, that doesn't mean that I've changed my mind about the importance of faith, the importance of belief, the importance of revelation. That still is the most fundamental thing. And then in chapter 3 he says, but there is this proof. And that's what he does in chapters 2 through 4.
I just saw a contradiction from when he says, unless I believe, I shall not understand. Well, he says that he can't understand unless he believes. Well, then he says, well, for people who don't believe in God, they do understand God's being, they just don't believe in it. Well, you just said it.
But you'll see that those little lines, this is a very dense, compact proof, as I think everybody sees. Very fast moving. And a lot of the lines that you're calling into attention now, we're going to have to look at very closely and very slowly to see what role they play in the proof. But let me hand out this version of the proof. Okay, the first thing I want to clarify here, let me zoom that out. This is the handout that you've just received. First thing I want to clarify is the origin of this thing. This is a version, a modern version, of Anselm's argument for the existence of God. It is something I've worked up based on material originally provided by a guy named William Rowe, Bill Rowe's a philosopher of religion, who you will read some of next week as we discuss another argument for God's existence, the cosmological argument. But he also is responsible for trying to reconstruct Anselm's argument in a more rigorous fashion, where the reasoning actually is more transparent, especially from line to line as you move through what Anselm intended as a very rigorous proof of the necessity of God's existence. Not just that God does exist, but that God has to exist, logically speaking. Now, what I've done, I haven't attributed this to Bill Rowe, because I've tweaked it up a little bit more. I've done some things that seem to me to be minor improvements, at least in clarifying this argument for the person being introduced to it for the first time. So what you have here is my reconstruction of William Rowe's reconstruction of St. Anselm's ontological argument for the existence of God. Now, that all wouldn't fit on that top line, so I've just said a modern reconstruction. Now, what I want, I'm going to zoom back on this a little bit so that you can see the whole thing. You've got it there before you. It's a good idea to be looking at your own copy of this as I go through it, but I need this to point. And I also would like you to mark this up in a certain way, because the very first thing I want to do before we go on to anything else is I want to explain to you the structure of this argument, and not the content so much. We'll get into that later. But right now, what I need to do is to clarify just how this proof is supposed to work. And again, it's set up in a way, I think you'll see, it's as if it were something like a proof in geometry or some other very rigorous logical discipline. Down here you see QED. I don't know whether that's a familiar expression to you. It stands for quad erat demonstrandum. It means which proves that which we set out to prove. It's something you put at the bottom of a proof when you are successful. What you have at the beginning, of course, is what every good proof should have, is a definition of key terms. And here you have a definition of God. The definition in question has got to be one that both the believer and the non-believer can agree to if this argument is going to have any force with non-believers. Now, that's what you try to do. You try and achieve a non-controversial definition, and we'll see how non-controversial this one is, but that's Anselm's attempt, and our attempt in this reconstruction to get at the essential character of God that is intended whenever anyone uses the expression of God, whether it's the believer saying that God does exist, or whether it's the atheist saying that God doesn't exist. That term has to mean something, and so we're trying to nail that down up here in the definition. Items 1, 2, and 3 are our initial assumptions. And I'd like, as I say, I'd like you to mark up your copy of the proof along with me so that you'll remember this. The structure is important. It's these three initial assumptions that Anselm imagines that both he and the non-believer, the atheist, can agree to. These two are supposed to be non-controversial. Now, to establish them, it turns out we, in this class, are going to spend most of our time discussing those things, because what's important here is to get agreement on the definition and on these first three propositions. They are the assumptions on which the rest of the proof is based. But supposedly nothing controversial is mentioned here. These are sort of like the axioms in geometry. They're supposed to be either self-evident or at least non-controversial beginnings for the proof. We start with those, and then we get to more surprising things as we go on, as we combine those, as we deduce things from those, etc. So lines 1, 2, and 3 are supposed to indicate initial assumptions with which the atheist is supposed to agree to, not just Anselm, both agree. So all of these things, all four, the definition, 1, 2, and 3, are supposed to be generally non-controversial, generally agreed to. The proof proper begins at line 4, and you'll notice that lines 4, 5, and 6 are indented. Okay? That's because what we have here in lines 4, 5, and 6 is a special kind of proof, which is alternatively called an indirect proof, or a conditional proof, or even a reductio ad absurdum. We'll come back to this sheet in a second. Let me just note, this is the conditional proof. Conditional or indirect proof. Because I want to talk about that for just a minute. Okay, so we'll come back to that one. First, let's talk about indirect proofs. Okay, what's an indirect proof? An indirect proof is one that does not proceed to its conclusion in a straightforward and direct way. You can think of an indirect proof as one that comes at its object, that comes at its goal in a kind of a roundabout fashion. Here, in our argument, line 4, I'd like you to look at that. It says, as a matter of fact, God exists only in the understanding. Now, this proof is going to depend a great deal on a distinction between existence in reality, on the one hand, and fictional existence, on the other. Think of, for example, Bart Simpson, who exists as a fictional character but doesn't exist in reality. That's the distinction we have in mind here. The atheist says that God is a fictional character. God exists only in the mind, only in people's minds, only in the understanding as it's set out here and in Anselm's original argument. But not in reality, says the atheist. The believer, on the other hand, argues that God exists both in the understanding and in reality. So you'll see that line 8, which is supposed to be the last line in this proof, line 8, which is Anselm's belief, says God exists in reality as well as in the understanding. That's what he's trying to prove, that God exists both in reality and in the understanding. Whereas the atheist view is expressed up here in line 4. As a matter of fact, God exists only in the understanding. What a peculiar thing for Anselm to do, you might think. He's got the atheist's view up there in line 4. Well, that's the kind of proof that's called an indirect proof. It's one that achieves its goal in what I'll call a roundabout, or an indirect is just a good, just as good word. In particular, what Anselm does here is to suppose, for the sake of the argument, that what the atheist says is correct. He says, in line 4, it's as if he says, okay, now, Mr. Atheist, we've agreed on the definition. We've agreed, of course that remains to be seen, but when he gets to line 4, he says, we've also agreed on lines 1, 2, and 3. We have no problem with these four things. Let's just say that you're right, that God exists only in the understanding. And then what Anselm is going to try to show is that this supposition, the atheist's belief, leads to a contradiction in just two short steps. The contradiction appears in line 6. Read after the "but then if 4 were true" for a second. This is the crucial contradiction. It would be possible for something to be greater than that than which nothing greater is possible. The contradiction there should be pretty transparent. How could it be possible for something to be greater than that than which nothing greater is possible? You're just saying, it's like saying, this black pen is not black. That's a contradiction, and this is too. It's just a little bit longer, a little bit more complicated one. So the proof, and we'll go through the proof in due course, but the point of the proof is to show that given the things that everybody would agree to, whether believer or not, given the definition in 1, 2, and 3, the atheist's belief can be shown to lead to a contradiction. The atheist's belief in 4, if we suppose that were true and put it together with these things, we get a contradiction. But if the atheist's belief really does lead to a contradiction, then it can't be true. That's the point. And that's what we say in 7. Line 7 simply says, basically, the supposition in line 4 must be false because it leads to a contradiction. Now that's the complicated part of the proof. It's not complete until we get to line 8. In line 8, we make use of line 1, which hasn't been used up to there. And again, we'll get back to that. But the only complicated part of the proof is this indirect part. Now, before I go on about indirect proofs, conditional proofs, and reductio ad absurdums, or absurdi, let me point out another thing about the way I've set this argument down on paper. After line 4, once the argument itself gets going, each line is followed by a parenthetical remark which explains where that line came from, so that 4, notice, is something that we suppose only for the sake of the argument. Line 5 comes, as it turns out, from plugging line 2 and line 4 into line 3. And line 6 comes from plugging the definition of God that we began with into line 5. Line 7 comes through lines 4 through 6 by indirect proof. And line 8 comes from combining 1 with 7. And that's what I say at each case. So you can track this out on your own, not just while I'm doing it for you. Now, back to this. An indirect proof achieves its goal in a roundabout way. It's a very respected mode of proof. It's not something that you really need to be suspicious of. If we weren't able to accomplish things through indirect proofs, mathematics, for example, would be very much impoverished. There'd be a lot of things that we can now prove that we couldn't prove if we weren't allowed to use indirect proof. It's got great logical credentials. There's nothing logically problematic about it. And if you think about it, it's a way that we argue kind of informally as well. Sometimes we argue that, you know, just in common conversations with people, sometimes I'll be trying to make a case and I'll say, now just wait a minute. Let's just suppose that what you say is correct. If that were true, then this other thing would be true, and we both know that's false. That's a kind of a less formal way of arguing. If you just say, let's just assume something for the sake of the argument. Let's assume your point of view for the sake of the argument. And then you go and show that that leads to something false, something silly, something that you both agree is improbable, whatever. When you argue in that way, you're arguing in this indirect way. So that's what indirect proof means. It achieves its goal in a roundabout way, usually by assuming the opposite of what you were originally trying to presume. But this proof is also called a conditional proof. Now these two things aren't equivalent, but it just so happens that this is also true about Ansel's argument. It's a conditional proof. What's that? Well, first of all, a conditional is any statement I'll put that in brackets, a conditional. Statement is an if A, then B type statement. Okay, a conditional statement is any if-then statement. A conditional proof is one that has that same sort of structure, that it starts with an assumption, and if something that you're just assuming for the moment, and draws some conclusion. I mean, in Ansel's argument, the basic conditional character of the argument can be understood by taking this word suppose and translating that to if. What we get is, if God existed only in the understanding, then this contradiction would be true, but contradictions can't be true, so therefore this statement must be false. You need to know this about conditional statements. This is another style of logical argument. You'll remember from our earlier brief discussions of logic, we had if all A is B and if all B is C, then all A is C. You remember that from earlier discussions of Plato and his epistemological theories. That is a valid logical form. Here is another valid logical form. If A, then B. A, there's the therefore line, B. If you know these two things, if you knew that if A, then B, and then if you also know that A, well, you can conclude B validly. But also, if A, then B, if you know that, and if you know not B, what can you validly conclude? You can validly conclude not A. Now, this is another conditional argument, and this is a valid argument form. If you know that whenever A happens, B must happen, and if you know that B hasn't happened, then you can validly conclude that A didn't happen, because if it had, you would have gotten B, and you don't have B. All right, so now that's what we're doing up here. If God exists only in the understanding, then you would get this contradiction. That's if A, then B. But contradictions are impossible, so not B. Therefore, not A. That's the structure of this argument, and that's why it's called a conditional proof. Okay? Finally, backing off once again, this type of argument may be called a reductio ad absurdum. Which plainly is Latin, or just simply a reductio, which is an abbreviation of that, because it attempts to reduce the opponent's belief to an absurdity. I mean, the point is that Anselm is trying to show that the atheist's belief makes no sense, can't be true. It's an absurdity. False, therefore. All of these things together. He reduces to the absurd his opponent's belief. That's why it's called reductio ad absurdum. Indirect proofs, conditional proofs, reductio ad absurdums, they occur in all kinds of areas in logic. They can be deployed in any topic at all. They're not dependent on anything in the philosophy of religion. But what I'm trying to get at here is that Anselm's argument is a conditional proof. It's an indirect proof. It's a reductio ad absurdum. It's a conditional proof because it goes in the back door. It achieves its goal in a roundabout way. It's a conditional proof because it achieves its goal by, first of all, assuming something, showing that it would lead to a consequence that is false. So therefore, that something must be also false, using a conditional argument. And finally, it's a reductio ad absurdum because it reduces the proposition that God exists only in the understanding, namely the atheist belief, to an absurdity. It shows that it leads to a contradiction. Okay, so there is the basic structure of this argument. Here's the definition of God that Anselm suggests that the atheists and we all should accept. Our object is to try and decide. I'm going to play the role of Anselm here. And you folks, I'd like to ask you, regardless of what your real belief is, I'd like to ask you to play the role of the skeptic, the non-believer, just so that we have a kind of an interplay here to try to establish this, whether or not this proof works. I need you to be suspicious of the claims that I make to this extent. I don't want you to just think up any old thing that might be wrong, but wherever you see something that seems not right, wherever I make a claim that this doesn't make sense to you, in my role as Anselm, I'm going to try to be persuading you of this argument, but when I fail to persuade, that's the time when I'd like to hear from you. That's when I need to get... Just at least ask me to clarify, but if you have a critique, if you have a particular complaint to make about some claim that I'm making, that's when I most need to hear from you. But your role is to be the atheists, regardless of what your real belief, and my role is, in spite of my real belief, my role is to try to present to you Anselm's argument and persuade you of the necessity of God's existence. So here's the definition that we begin with. Anselm defines God as that than which nothing greater is possible. Than which nothing greater is possible. I take it that the possibility that we're talking about here is logical possibility, not just a physical possibility. And we'll have to talk later about the word greater to clarify what we mean there. For now, suffice it to say, it has something to do with power or potency. But God is that than which nothing greater is possible. Now, in parentheses, I've re-expressed this in other terms, because sometimes these other terms are used. God is that than which nothing greater can be conceived. That works just as well, provided you don't think of conception as some sort of limited human capacity. What's conceivable is what's logically possible. What's inconceivable is what's not logically possible. Logical possibility is what really is at stake here. So it's not just because I'm lacking in imagination or something, that I'm not able to conceive something greater than God. It's because nothing greater than God is even possible. That's the definition. God is that than which nothing greater is possible. I want you to understand this as, I'm not sure I'm spelling this properly, but I'll try, an insurpassability. Condition. On the definition of God. In order to be God, something has to be insurpassable in greatness, which is just another way of saying God is that than which nothing greater is possible. So this insurpassability condition, or criterion, if you like, is the essential characteristic of God that we're going to focus our attention on. Much more could be said and is said by believers in God and non-believers alike. Much more can be said about God, but we're interested in establishing a minimal definition, one that the largest possible numbers of people can agree to. The objective with regard to the atheist is to establish a definition of the term God that captures what the atheist means when the atheist says there is no God. And so for this definition, presumably Anselm and other believers would say there is out there in some sense, not physically, but spiritually, but there exists really. In other words, this isn't just a fiction, it is real. There exists a God, namely a being, a something than which nothing greater is even possible. Such a being, such a thing exists in reality. The atheist may accept the definition, but say, but the atheist would say that there is no such thing, that it's just a fiction. There is nothing than which nothing greater is possible. There is no such thing out there. There's no such thing that qualifies as a God on this insurpassability condition. I want you to notice an important fact about this definition. To say that God is that than which nothing greater is possible is to say something a great deal more than you'd be saying if you merely said God is the greatest thing that exists. I want to compare those two things. God equals that than which nothing greater is possible. Versus God is the greatest thing that exists. These two things are very different. This says more than that. Now, whether, I mean, it's difficult to quantify over these things and figure out, well, what's more than what, but this is a stronger claim about God. That's what I mean. It's a stronger claim than this. If someone were to try to define God in this way, there are extremely good reasons why both the atheist and the believer would have to reject the definition. Neither the atheist nor the believer are really likely, if they're sort of normal atheists and normal believers, they're not likely to find that definition acceptable at all as a definition. Now, the believer believes that God is the greatest thing that exists, but that's not good enough as a definition of God. The atheist straightforwardly can't agree with this definition. Why? Why would the atheist not like that definition? To start off with the easy one.
How does he exist?
Pardon?
How do you know that he exists?
Well, if you say that God is the greatest thing that exists, maybe this is what you're seeing. You're conceding already in the definition the existence of God. Right? So it's better to not make that conception. God is that than which nothing greater is even possible. God is that than which nothing greater is even conceivable. It's quite different from saying God is the greatest thing that exists, and for that reason the atheist can't accept the first definition, but God is can't agree that God is the greatest thing that exists, but could conceivably accept the definition that says God is that than which nothing greater is conceivable. Now, why wouldn't the believer be able to go along with the definition God is the greatest thing that exists? me ask you to perform a thought experiment, which has a sort of a limited relevance, but I think I hope it'll get to the main point here. Forget, until the end of this story, forget religious questions about God. And just sort of bear with me in the story. Let's say that we, all of us, are members of the crew of the Starship Enterprise, okay? And we're out there sailing around the universe, going where nobody's gone before, like that's what we're supposed to do. So we're just cruising around, you know, getting into trouble from time to time, solving people's problems, rescuing the entire universe over and over again. But somehow we've really gone someplace where nobody's ever been before. I mean, we've got someplace that's just completely black. I mean, there's no stars, there's nothing around. We're way off any charts that we've got. We don't know how we got there. And so that's the adventure for this week's episode. We start off, we find ourselves in a strange place, and our instruments aren't recording anything near or far, at least at first. And so we're cruising around. I suppose we're cruising around at warp speed because we want to get out as fast as we can, but we're cruising around. And from time to time, we take readings to see if there's anything new. And for the longest time, there's just nothing out there. But then eventually, somebody comes up excitedly to whichever commander it is. You can imagine this in any one of the different Star Trek series. And announces that they finally got some readings off in this direction. And so they make a big thing out of that. And the readings, they make a beeline for that place, and the readings are becoming more and more detailed, and they're learning more and more about it. And one of the things they find very quickly is that it's kind of unique. I mean, there's one thing out there. It's not like the edge of some galaxy, but there's just one very big thing out there. And then there's, again, nothing at all for billions of parsecs or whatever the unit of measurement is. And then as we get closer and closer to this whatever it is, we begin to realize that it's spherical. It's spherical. And what's peculiar about this sphere is that we're getting more and more indications that suggest that it's made out of a material that we've never known of before, but it's plainly a hard material. And then as we get really close, because this doesn't take very long, we're after all on a Star Trek mission, we get really close, we see that this sphere is really quite perfect. It really looks like an artifact. And the reason that this is fascinating is because the sphere, according to our measurements, is about 186 million miles in diameter. It's huge. So somebody did put a lot of work into this thing. It's an artifact, right? It's big, big, huge ball hanging in space, nothing else around it anywhere. So we're puzzling over this thing and reading all the data that we can get off every instrument that we can direct at it. And finally, we realize that on one of these instruments, we're receiving a signal. And so we quickly patch that into the communicator, which is a big television screen that's right there in the bridge, and as is usually the case, it flashes on, and there before us are a bunch of people that look an awful lot like human beings. There might be some small differences, but they look remarkably like us. Maybe they don't have pointy ears, so they're not Vulcans, but maybe they have a pointy nose. I don't know what they have, but they look very much like us, maybe one little thing that's different. And again, as is usual in Star Trek cases, we've never seen any of these people before. They've never seen us. They begin speaking, and immediately it somehow gets translated into English. And the dubbing is so good that it looks like they're speaking in English. I mean, it's just an incredible device that the Enterprise has. But in any case, they're speaking, and they speak in English, and they say, hi. They say, we haven't had a visitor for quite some time, but we're really happy to see you, that you're there. And they're these happy-go-lucky, friendly folks, right? They're not being stern or any of the stuff that sometimes happens when there's another thing they're not doing. They're not being stern, so we know they're not enemies. But they're also not being sort of flaky, so we know they're not, wonderful religious sorts of characters. They're just kind of normal, regular people who are glad to see some visitors. Maybe the only thing that's really striking is they seem absolutely fearless. They have no concern at all about any danger that we might potentially be able to bring to them. They have no worries about that at all. And we pick that up as we watch them. They said, boy, they seemed like they're just completely relaxed, at ease with themselves. They didn't seem suspicious or worried about us at all. I mean, we could be the worst people in the universe, but you know, they don't seem to care. And as we think about this, we realize that it might be because their technology is so remarkably ahead of ours that they've got nothing to fear from us. I mean, we may appear to them to be something like natives on a desert island or something like that, because they have a technology that's allowed them to do something that we can't even really imagine. Actually, we've imagined it. These are actually called Dyson spheres, as it will turn out. Requires a lot of resources. You've got to truck things from someplace, or else you have to create matter out of energy. I mean, it's hard to figure out how you do that. You know, maybe dismantle a solar system or something like that for that kind of material. But we're intrigued, and they invite us in. They say, look, come on down and visit us. We haven't seen anybody for a long time. We'd love to talk to you, find out about your society, tell you whatever you want to know about ours. And so we agree. Now we're not going to send the entire Starship Enterprise crew, both for safety reasons and just for technical reasons. Somebody's got to run the ship, I guess, for the most part. So we, the people in this room, you guys and me, we're going to be the away party, right? So we gather around the transporter room. Does anyone know why there has to be a transporter room if they got transporters? I mean, why do they have to do that? Why can't they just say, zip, wherever you are in the ship, just zip you wherever you're going to go? So we gather down in the transporter room, and I suppose we have to take turns at the pods, because I don't think there's enough pods there for all of us at once. And we stand there in sort of adventurous-looking positions as we're being transported, and they transport us down to this sphere. And where they transport us, though, is not to the surface, the outer surface of the sphere. And we were sort of surprised. We didn't detect any sorts of structures out there that would give us clues as to what this thing was. But we were transported, as we materialize at our destination and realize, we're transported to the inside surface of the sphere. And we're out of doors when we're transported there, and we look up and we see a bright sun. And we realize that what these folks have done is to construct a shell, a big sphere, completely encircling a star. That's what the Dyson sphere is called. And that means they collect all the radiation from the star on the surface, the inner surface of the sphere. And if you could imagine what the surface area would be like. I mean, we've got, we're living on this little tiny speck, this planet Earth out here at 93 million miles away. And the surface, the interior surface of their sphere is also 93 million miles from the center. Why I had to calculate quickly the distance, the whole diameter, and yet they're not just a little speck. They've got the entire interior surface to populate, to use for whatever living purposes they have. They have constructed in such a way so that the crops can be grown. They've constructed in such a way so that all the industry that they need can be performed in there. And their population is in numbers that are just truly astronomical. And there's plenty of room, plenty of space. But the numbers of people that can be stored on this sphere is huge. And we're trying to figure out it must have taken them a long time to build this sphere. And we're surprised to learn as we go through. We stay down there for a week, 2 weeks, occasionally go back up to the ship. But we're learning as much as we can. And in particular, we're trying to learn how in the hell can we get back to wherever it is we want to go to. It's not Earth necessarily, but how can we get back to known parts of space? And they're going to help us. They just got to figure out what we're telling them when we tell them where we're from. But there should be no problem with that. It just takes us a little while to figure out where you're from, and then we'll tell you how to get back there. So they're helping us with that, and we have all kinds of questions about their technology. They're giving us all the information we can use. They opened up all their libraries. There's nothing secret for them. There's just limits to what we can absorb. And we find out they really are light years beyond us in understanding the physical universe. And we find out they've built billions of these spheres. mean, this isn't the only one. This is just the only one in the immediate vicinity. There's others sprinkled throughout, you know, usually off the edges of the farthest expanse of the cosmos. But there's billions of these things out there. And so we're saying, what kind of time scale are we talking about? And they say, well, you know, we've been working on this stuff. I mean, our records indicate we've been working on these things for at least the last 40 billion years. Now that surprises us a bit, since we didn't think the universe itself was that old. And so you know, we talked to them about that, and they say, yeah, that's right. The universe isn't as old as our civilization is. And that's a kind of a new thing in our history. And talking to them further, we realize that the individuals themselves are many billions of years old. Long ago, billions and billions of years ago, they figured out how to conquer death and conquer all diseases. And so the individuals we're talking about are sometimes 6, 10, 20 billion years old. The people, the individual people. And they're just normal folks. They don't act like they're really wise and old. They don't have bald heads and robes and stuff. They're just normal folks. Far too many of them have baseball caps, just like down here. But it, you know, it's just kind of a normal world. And it just, they're very, very smart. And they're very, very old. Well, we're absorbing everything we can, and in due course, they figure out where it is that we're trying to get to by our descriptions, and they refit our ship so that we can get there more quickly because we need a technology that we don't now have, and we're kind of getting ready to go. We've spent a little bit more time just trying to get all kinds of information for later analysis. We've filled up all of the memory banks in all of our big, huge Starship Enterprise computers with as much data as we possibly can, and it's just about time to go. And so they, you know, invite us to come down to the local bar to, you know, have a last drink before we. And you know, they make the best beer. You know, I mean, they know all the secrets of the universe, so they make this perfect beer. And so we're having a glass of beer, sitting up at the bar, and talking with amongst ourselves and how amazing the whole thing has been. And the bartender comes over and says, you know, I haven't got a chance to talk to you folks, but remind me again exactly, you know, what were the coordinates that we figured out that your civilization originally came from? And, you know, because we've been saying that, well, the whole civilization originally comes from Earth, although now we've spread out to all parts of our galaxy anyway. And in the last couple of days, we finally figured out what those coordinates were in their system, so we tell him. And he says, wow, that's so incredible. Now, let me get this straight. That's just real close to this other star. It's way out there on this spiral, right? On your galaxy. And you call that the Milky Way galaxy? Okay. Yeah, I see why you call it that, because it looks like that from your planet, doesn't it? It just looks like a spiral to us. But your star system is located out there on that arm. You're real close to this other star, aren't you? And he describes Alpha Centauri really, really precisely. Now, Alpha Centauri happens to be the closest star to us. And we say, yeah, we're about 4.6 light years from there. We're real close. It's just right in our neighborhood. He says, this is the most amazing coincidence. He says, let me buy you guys another beer. He buys the beer. He says, and we're wondering why he's so excited, and ask him. And he finally says, well, I got to tell you this. I mean, this is amazing. About, I don't know, 6 billion years ago, I don't know when it was, but I was doing my training, you know, in a physics course I was taking. And one of the projects was to design, you know, a couple of star systems. So I designed a couple of star systems. Yours was one of them. I mean, yours was one of the star systems that I designed. I mean, I just sort of brought the matter together, out of the gases, and I got it spinning just right, and you know, sprinkled some of the comets with my own DNA. I mean, I'm not supposed to do that. I used my own DNA, sprinkled, and you must be the product of my work. This is so fantastic. It's just so neat to see you. You know? And he obviously took a little bit of some of the pride in the whole thing. Now back to the discussion about God. I want you to consider, now in that group, the away party from the Starship Enterprise, there are going to be some believers and there's going to be some disbelievers. And I'm confident of that. I'd like to ask you, you know, without, I don't care whether you're a believer or a disbeliever, I want to know what you think the believers in that crowd, I mean, how would they react? Let's just say that their belief took this form. They believed that God created the heavens and the earth. And let's also say that they've got all the evidence in the world before them that the bartender's story is correct. He really did produce the solar system as a science project. Do you think that they, you know, would their reaction would be, this is God? This bartender here, I mean, this God has been serving me drinks here? I mean, is that their reaction? I don't think so either. And it's partially because of what the notion of God means to someone who believes in God. What would the believer's reaction be?
No
way that this guy created the...
This guy isn't God.
Okay, no God. I mean, consistent. Is that consistent with thinking that, well, this guy did create the heavens and the earth?
I just don't think that they would really believe.
What would they think? What would their reaction be?
I think that they would think that he was just a tool that God used to create.
Or whatever the details. I mean, I think that the logical question for the believer is, well, wonder who created this guy and this guy's civilization. I mean, just pushes it back a little bit, because God isn't just some very, very great being. God isn't just whatever it is that happens to be the greatest thing in the universe, because in every universe, you know, whether there is a character that's divine or not, there's going to be something that's the greatest. I mean, define what the term great means, and on that definition, there will be something that's the greatest thing in the universe. The believer can't accept that just any old thing that happens to be very, very great is God. God is something, and here we return to this definition, than which nothing greater is even possible. If you can, in your mind, ask the question, what created this thing, then you're not thinking about God. That's why the question that atheists often ask of believers, like, namely the question, well, what created God? That question hardly even makes sense to the believer, because to the believer, God is defined as something that requires no further explanation. God is something that could not have been created, because that would imply something greater than God. What Anselm is trying to do is to isolate the essential feature of any definition of God. For our purposes, it is not yet important, although Anselm goes on later in his proslogion to address these other questions, it's not important that God is good, God knows a lot. What's important, the essence of God, is his unsurpassable greatness. God is something than which none greater is even conceivable. And that's what he means by God when he says he believes in God. That's the core of the meaning. And if the atheist is to accept that definition, it has to be reasonable for the atheist to say, okay, that's fine as far as the meaning of the term goes. I mean, I can define Santa Claus, I can define unicorns, and that makes sense as a definition of God, but that's just exactly what it is that I say doesn't exist in reality. That's what it would mean for the atheist to agree with that definition. This brings up a distinction that I want to spend a little bit of time talking about. It's a distinction that comes up in lots of different contexts, not just here. The distinction I have in mind is between what are called necessary conditions on the one hand, and sufficient conditions on the other. Now, you'll remember that in talking about the definition of God up here, I referred to the definition as encoding or expressing an insurpassability condition. Whenever we define terms, what we're doing is setting out the conditions for using terms. You can think of this not just linguistically. You can think that we set out conditions for what a thing is. Let me give you an example. How about, blue denim pants. Now, if I uttered this expression to someone who'd never heard of blue denim pants, they might not want to know what I mean, or what it would take for something to be an example of blue denim pants. Well, I point out that, well, for one thing, have to be blue. That's a necessary condition. Okay. That's a necessary condition of being blue denim pants, is that they have to be blue. They also have to be denim. That's another one, another necessary condition. And they also have to be pants. A blue railroad locomotive wouldn't do. It has to be blue denim pants. Have to satisfy all three of those different necessary conditions. Notice that no one of them is enough. Together, they are jointly sufficient. Okay. So necessary conditions are requirements. All right. If something's to qualify as a pair of blue denim pants, they have to satisfy each of those necessary conditions, no one of which is sufficient. It wouldn't be enough just to be pants, because they might be red. Wouldn't be enough to be denim, might be a shirt. Wouldn't be enough to be blue, because it might be a railroad car or a who knows what. Sufficient conditions are different. An example, Levi 501 blue jeans. Now this is an example of blue denim pants. If something is a pair of Levi 501 blue jeans, then that's sufficient, that's enough for it to be a pair of blue denim pants. But it's not necessary. It doesn't have to be Levi. It doesn't have to be 501. Okay? Could be something else. Sufficient conditions are not required. They are enough. Okay. Something can be enough without being necessary. And that's the difference between necessary conditions and sufficient conditions. So, once again, notice that in both cases we're talking about the definition or the characterization of blue denim pants. We picked out some things that are necessary conditions for being blue denim pants. You have to be blue, you have to be denim, you have to be pants. And then we've also, on the other hand, looked at sufficient conditions. Levi 501 blue jeans is a sufficient condition for being a pair of blue denim pants, but it's not necessary. So, things can be necessary conditions but not sufficient, like being blue. And things can be sufficient conditions but not necessary, like being a pair of Levi 501 blue jeans. Now, where that comes up in our discussion of Anselm is right here. This definition sure looks like, at first glance, it is supposed to set out a necessary condition. In order for something to be a god, it ought to be something insurpassable in greatness. God is that than which nothing greater is possible, that than which nothing greater is even conceivable. Okay? That makes it seem that if something fell short of this, if something did not have this insurpassability condition, then it could not be God under this definition. So I take it that Anselm intends this definition as setting out, at least, that this definition comprises a necessary condition for being God. Interestingly, though, it seems also that Anselm must imagine that this is a sufficient condition for being God, because after all, he offers us a proof which shows that God, as defined in this definition, exists in reality as well as in the understanding. So if we prove the existence of that than which nothing greater is possible, we've done enough, according to Anselm and according to this proof, we've done enough to demonstrate the existence of God. Now that's tantamount to saying that this is not only a necessary condition, but a sufficient condition. Now that may prove an interesting issue later on as you examine this thing. Okay, now the question arises as to what this word greater means in the definition. My own understanding of that term has mostly to do with power, and then power has got a lot of different interpretations itself, but I guess the most general one that I can think of, and it's the one that I think we should consider as being met here, abilities to do things, potency, I think is the basic root idea behind greatness as intended here. So again, not size, and not specifically, and here we begin to get into some necessary vagueness, because we are talking about divinity after all. It's hard to get too specific about this, but the power isn't necessarily physical either. I mean, it's going to include the abilities to do remarkable things. It's I think of the three properties that I listed on my three hands just a few minutes ago. And there's the goodness, again, as I say, is fairly clear what that means. Wisdom, it's fairly clear what that means. Neither of those get at the idea that God is all-powerful. God can do anything that God wants. God is the author of everything that is. All of these ideas about God, I think, are to be found somehow or another embedded in that admittedly vague idea of greatness. And it's that idea that Anselm wants to at least refer to in saying that God is, by definition, that than which nothing greater, nothing more potent, nothing more powerful can even be conceived. And that's also, we've got to be careful about this, because this is supposed to be a proof. So every time a word like that comes up, it better be used in the same sense. But that also should be what we mean later when we get, for example, to line 3, where the word greater appears again, that we should be using this, the word in the same way if this is if this proof is to be worth its salt. Brian.
Well, I have two questions. One thing is further into these chapters, he says that God can't do everything. And then,
like he can't do contradictory things?
Right, like, can't you? Yeah. Mm-hmm. But the other thing I'm saying, like, if we're trying to describe the existence of God, how do you say what God is?
Well, you can't say all of it.
I mean, like, he may be greater than what can be conceived, but greater in terms of.
Well, really, what we're doing here is defining a word. And we can certainly do that. I mean, what is it that I mean? What's the root meaning of the word that I'm using here? And that's what Anselm is purporting to do. And of course, and the tricky part of doing this is that the argument is supposed to commit not only Anselm's fellow believers, but also the non-believers. So he's got to pick a definition that the atheist can accept as well. And I think, just for my own part, it seems to me that this isn't a bad candidate, because the atheist is in a position to say, all right, let's let God be that than which nothing greater can be conceived. I certainly don't think there's anything like that out there. And so if that's what you're telling me God is, fine, let's go for it. I don't believe that that exists.
I mean, it's like, if you just look at like matter exists like everywhere. Well, if God's, I know, well, that's actually a condition of size, but I mean, like, where is God? How do you say God's out?
Well, I don't think you do. And I think most believers would argue, and this sometimes seems bewildering, but I think there are ways of understanding this that make sense out of it. God isn't in space. God isn't in time. God transcends these things. There are lots of funny roots to starting to talk like that. They're not all religious, but It may have come up before, but in a way, what physicists are now saying about the origins of this universe, namely that it arose in something that they give the name Big Bang to, that it arose in a Big Bang, that Big Bang is technically supposed to be the origin of space and time as well as of mass energy. So it doesn't occur in time, and it doesn't occur in space. And there may be some sense to saying that, when you're trying to pinpoint, well, what can we say about it? You can't say when it happened or where it happened. It happened somehow. Now that leaves a little bit of conceptual cloudiness and conceptual confusion. I mean, doesn't mean, I'm not saying that the Big Bang theory is confused. I'm just saying it leaves you a little bit not certain of what exactly you're being told in it. And I think that that's the same way that both believers and non-believers feel about the idea that God is not actually someplace, some when. He's not sitting on a planet, for example. You know, he's not holding court. Some religions believe that God is, in fact, sitting in a place. So, I mean, it's not all religions agree on this score, but if we're talking about mainstream Christianity, for example, or mainstream Western religions, for the most part, God is something spiritual. God isn't something physical, so therefore God doesn't exist as a physical thing in time today. Any questions about any part of the definition at this point? Not just clarificatory, but any critical comments even. Don't have any questions. I mean, I'm now asking you to play the role that I assigned to you. I'm trying to be Anselm. I need you to be the critic. I need you to play the role of the non-believer, the fool who in his heart says that there is no God, while I, who am such a fool, I will try my best to play the role of Anselm. Yes?
Looking at this argument here, it doesn't prove anything to me.
Okay, you're looking at the argument as a whole.
Yeah, and a couple places it just seems like, how is it connected?
Well, that remains to be seen, and I let me ask you to hold off on that one. Right now it's very important to go through this step by step if it's to have any plausibility at all. So right now, I want to stick with that definition. Anything wrong with that? Can the atheist accept that?
I can.
Can't?
Can.
Cannot?
No.
Okay, why?
It doesn't prove anything to me.
The definition isn't supposed to prove. Maybe it's your way of putting it that I'm not getting clear on. Now, the definition is just supposed to be a definition. It's not supposed to prove anything at all. If it did, you know, then if it proved, for example, that God existed all by itself, then the atheist isn't going to accept it. And that's why the atheist can't accept a definition that went, God is the greatest thing that exists. We went over that before. The reason the atheist can't accept that is because it already says God exists. But this doesn't say that. This says God is that than which nothing greater can even be conceived. And I wonder if there's any reason why the atheist shouldn't accept that as the definition of God. I mean, then the atheist presumably would go ahead and say, fine, that's the definition of God, and that's exactly what doesn't exist. Something like that. There isn't anything like that. There isn't anything than which nothing greater can even be conceived. Yeah?
I think that you really can't think of something that nothing greater than can be conceived. Like, for example, if you like think of the greatest number that you can conceive, all I would have to do is like add one to it, and I just thought of something.
Well, the concept of greatness that's involved here has to do with power or potency. And the concept of greatest number, that's different. If we slid from one interpretation of the word greatness to another in the course of this proof, then we certainly would be making a mistake. I mean, you can't do that. But when we're talking about God, we're not just talking about, I can't even think of words to describe what the numeric sense of greatness is, but it's all perfectly clear what we mean when we say that two is greater than one, and it's not that two can do more things than one. That's not what we mean. It's not that two is more powerful than one. But, you know, like, I think there are parallels there, but they are just that. They're parallels and analogies. We can talk about, and I think this has been probably something that has occurred to some of you, in infinity in the world of mathematics. As an adjective, the adjective infinite, when it indicates the number series, indicates that the number series has a number of cardinal numbers, this is very difficult to put accurately, that than which no other cardinal number is greater. And curiously, what that means in the case of the number series is that there isn't a last one. Right? They just keep on going. You can always add one, and to any number that you name. If you treated infinity itself as a number, and I think that's probably not a good idea, but if you treated infinity itself as a number, as sometimes is done, then you come up with this peculiarity about infinity as a number. If you add one to infinity, you still get infinity. In other words, infinity, if treated as a number, is a number than which no number can be greater. No greater number can even be conceived. I mean, that's its definition. Now, I think infinity probably is best not treated as a number itself. But that's for technical reasons. I think it's best, rather, just to describe the natural number series as infinite and use it as an adjective. But that's an analogy. And it's not, God here is described in terms of greatness. And the greatness isn't the same kind of, we're not talking about numeric magnitude, we're talking about potency, power. And if there were anything like that, that wasn't a god, that would be an interesting phenomenon. Anyway, we got the definition, and I don't think I'm going to satisfy everybody 100%, but let's move on to these three propositions, because I want to get all three of those presented to the critic's satisfaction. And remember, I continue to need you to be the critic of these things. All right, number one, let me explain what I think is meant by it. And then let me ask you whether you think that the atheist should buy it. Number one, Anselm urges, should go without saying. God at least exists in the understanding. Now, of course, Anselm would want to go on to say God exists not only in the understanding, but also in reality. Whereas the atheist, presumably, would want to stop right there. I mean, the atheist would want to say God exists only in the understanding. But I believe that all he means to suggest here in number one is that at least we know what we're talking about. And if the atheist said, no, we don't, I disagree with one, then Anselm would say, well then, your claim that God doesn't exist is simply gibberish then, because you're not intending anything by that term. You don't mean anything by that term. If you didn't have some meaning for the term, and after all, we just have agreed on a definition, but if you didn't have some understanding of what that term meant, then saying that God doesn't exist would be exactly like saying, but Flabberschlap doesn't exist. I mean, there's a term that has no meaning. I mean, I just made it up right then. Now, somebody could assign it a meaning, but to say say meaningfully or significantly that God doesn't exist, that requires, logically speaking, that the word God have some meaning, that it have some meaning that the utterer understands. And that's all that Anselm implies in saying that God exists at least in the understanding. He says, now, surely, Mr. Atheist, you can go along with that, that God exists in the understanding. A. So I put it to you. Is that something that's reasonable for the atheist to accept? Okay, we can come back to these, and to the definition for that matter, if later on a problem develops. But let's move to two. Anselm thinks that the atheist ought to agree with the claim that the existence of God in reality is possible. Now, some might think that that the atheist shouldn't agree to that, wouldn't agree to that. But let's remember, once again, that the possibility in question is logical. Possibility. Anselm's not arguing that the atheist ought to agree that God obeys physical laws or anything like that. Anselm is just claiming, in offering this as a supposedly uncontroversial premise in this argument, Anselm's just claiming that the idea of God and an existence in reality are not logically inconsistent. There's nothing contradictory when you put those two things together. Here are some examples of some things that would be impossible on this strong sense of impossibility. For one thing, married bachelors are impossible. Why? Well, because the definition of bachelor rules out being married. And so that's a contradictory expression and an impossible existent. It's not possible for something like that to exist any more than, here's another one, round squares. The definition of square conflicts with the definition of round in such a way so that one and the same thing can't be both round and a square, just as one and the same thing can't be both married and a bachelor. Okay? That's what we mean to say that something is impossible. So what Anselm is claiming is that surely the atheist does not believe God to be God's existence in reality to be contradictory. Now, if the atheist does think that or claims that the existence of God in reality is a logical impossibility, Anselm's entitled, I think, to say, well, then where's the proof? I mean, to say that something is logically impossible suggests that there's a straightforward contradiction in it, just like round, square, or married bachelor. Characteristically, that's not what atheists claim. Atheists claim merely that God is not actual. So all that Anselm is asking the atheist to concede here is that God is not impossible. Not that God's actual. Put it in this order. Some things are possible. Some things are actual. Some things are impossible. That's not the best order in the world. Because I just happen to think of I might as well bring out the other category, which doesn't come up here quite yet. Some things are also necessary. So don't worry about the order here. But notice some interesting. So there's actually four. Modes, modalities of things that are of interest. If something's possible, that doesn't mean it's actual. I'm just going to point to some of the relationships here. But if something is actual, it does mean that it has to have been possible. If something's impossible, that definitely means that it's not possible. It also means it can't be actual. I mean, those are logical relationships among these different modalities, as I'm calling them. All that number two suggests is that God is possible. If God were necessary or actual, Both of those would require that God also be possible. The only one that's left, the only one that's left for someone who wants to deny number two, to deny that God is possible, is to claim that. And that would require a proof. And if you don't have a proof, well, that by itself indicates that you're not certain and that God is therefore possible. Brian?
I don't agree with the actual having to be possible, because if something's possible, it has a chance to not exist, but if something's actual, it has to exist. So actual is not.
No, I see what you're saying. Let me go back to this one then. I believe you're interpreting possible in this way, that to say that something is possible implies that it's not necessary. Because what you said is, to say that something's possible implies that it's also, it's possible for it to not happen too. I'm trying to think about this. I think Aristotle sometimes talked about possibility in that way.
Yeah,
but there's a lot of different ways you can talk about possibility, and I'm urging you to think of it slightly differently. That is, to say that something is possible leaves open even the possibility that it's also necessary. All this says is not impossible. Okay?
But something that's possible can turn to be actual, but once it becomes actual, there's no way that actual was possible, because there's a chance for it to happen.
Well, I urge you to think about a different, perfectly normal meaning of the term possible. And that's the term in which, well, it has to have been possible for this pen to be on this desk, because damn it, it is, right? So it can't be impossible. It has to be possible for it to be on the desk, because
yeah,
there it is.
But if it wasn't there, there was still a chance for it to be there. But
that's right. But you're trying to go the other way. You're trying to say that if it is on the desk, then it can't have been possible for it to be on the, it can't be possible for it to be on the desk. And I'm saying that doesn't really make sense. I mean, because to say that it isn't possible for it to be on the desk is pretty straightforwardly to imply that it can't be here,
I think,
and yet there it is.
The difference is in time, because before it was possible, now it's actual.
So I understand what you're saying, but I urge you to instead look at this way, that the actuality of something requires its possibility. Because if it were not possible, think about that, if it were not possible, then it couldn't be actual.
Well, I guess they just don't exist at the same time.
Right now, it is possible for this to be, for me to be standing before you. Because if it weren't possible for me to be standing before you, I mean, that's the deny. I mean, if you're going to deny that it's possible for me to be standing before you, that's to say it's not possible for me to be standing before you, right? But of course, it is possible for me to be standing before you. I'm doing it. Okay? Yeah?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but don't most atheists say God is impossible?
I don't. I don't know about most. I mean, we don't get together at conventions or things.
from what I think is, like,
God is too good to be true. How about that one?
Well, God was created by people to explain things that they couldn't explain. And now science can explain everything. So there's no way we can't prove.
Well, that's just simply false. I hope that, I take issue with an atheist who said that we can explain everything right off the bat. We can't. As a matter of fact, the more we explain, the more new things we find that we can't explain, and it's probably going to keep on going like that. The prospects of our ever getting to a point where we can explain everything seem to be pretty dim. There'll always be questions. And curiously, I just saw in the newspaper the other day that who knows about these polls, who knows what their origin is, and I don't know, you know, how respectable the poll taker was, but, you know, scientists have recently been polled concerning their belief in God, and I think the upshot of the poll was that the proportion of scientists who believe in God is still hovering right around 50%, which is right around where it was in 1916, the last time such a poll was conducted. So, I know just from knowing scientists that the mix is about the same as in the rest of society concerning belief in God. For many scientists, the discoveries that have animated the 20th century are actually yet more evidence for the awesome nature of God. Albert Einstein famously, in part of his argument with Niels Bohr concerning the nature of quantum mechanics, famously argued that God doesn't play dice. Now, while he just meant that, I think, to sort of make a point about nature. Nature isn't going to be indeterminate in the way that you seem to suggest it is, Niels. Nonetheless, I think there's some evidence that Einstein had an idea of God that animated him religiously. It wasn't anybody else's idea. It was his own. So I think... atheists are at least on safer ground if they simply say that God isn't actual. That's what I say. I mean, God, I don't deny that God is possible. No, not anymore, obviously, in my Anselm character. My position is that God is not bloody likely. There's not any particularly good reason to think that God exists. But I think Anselm is on perfectly safe ground to say, if you, Mr. Atheist, think that God is impossible, let's see the proof. And if you have no proof, it won't do just to think that God is impossible, because that leaves, not having a proof, leaves God possible. Right? Just the bare not having of a proof. You can think that God is impossible all you want, but that still leaves open the possibility that you're wrong. Show me the proof, and then, I mean, that's a big, bold claim to say that God is impossible, and you certainly don't need to make that to be an atheist. All you need is, the only claim you need to make is that God isn't actual. All right, now I want us to look at number three. Number three is plainly it's the wordiest of the three premises that Anselm wants everyone to agree to, but it's not particularly difficult. Let me just read that to you. Lots depends on how you phrase it, because it's a long, complicated sentence, but it breaks down pretty easily. It says when you see sentences that start with if, recognize that this is one of those conditionals we spoke about a few minutes ago. If the existence of something in reality is possible, but as a matter of fact, that thing exists only in the understanding, then it's possible for something to be greater than that thing. Okay, and what is that possibility? Well, that's in parentheses. What would be greater than that thing would be that same thing existing in reality rather than only in the understanding. Now, let's just break out, first of all, the form of that sentence. Okay. This, as I say, is one of those conditionals. If blank, put in now, then blank. Before we had A and B, put anything you want in there. In a conditional, any old conditional, the part in the first clause that follows the if is called the antecedent, which basically means it's what comes first. If antecedent, then this part is always called the consequent. If antecedent, then consequent. Now what we have in number three is a complex antecedent. It has two parts. Okay, I'll just move that up there. We have if, now I'll put in some letters, A and B, then C, where A is the existence of something in reality is possible. B is that thing exists only in the understanding. C is it is possible for something to be greater than that thing. All right. Now I also want you to see, again, this is a complex sentence where the word something appears as a variable. Let me write it out without something. If the existence, I'll write it so I want to have it to point to, of X instead of something in reality is possible. But, as a matter of fact, X exists only in the understanding. Then it is possible. Now this time, for something. This is the reason for pulling the variable out, is to distinguish X from the thing that could be greater than X. But it's a peculiar relationship, namely X existing in the reality not just in the understanding. Now this is fairly, you can see that it's got a complicated structure just by reading it in the first place, but it, you know, the structure comes out a bit when I put it this way. If the existence of X in reality is possible, but X, as a matter of fact, exists only in the understanding, then it's possible for something to be greater than X, namely X existing in reality, not just in the understanding. Take Santa Claus as an example. Now, I take it that most of you realize that the Santa Claus, I mean, I don't want this to shock anyone, so maybe, I should have chosen something less sensitive. But the fact of the matter is, I have to tell you, Santa Claus doesn't exist in reality. Santa Claus is only in the mind. But Santa Claus's existence in reality is surely not a logical impossibility. I mean, there's all kinds of funny things about, you know, flying around with reindeer and stuff and managing to get down chimneys and things like that. Those are physical impossibilities, but there's nothing contradictory about the idea that there's such a character that flies around at Christmas time. At least I don't know of a proof. I don't know of a proof that Santa Claus can't exist in reality. And short of a proof, I have to accept that as unlikely as Santa Claus is, he's at least possible. So my situation with Santa Claus is like the atheist's situation concerning God. I would concede, and I think everyone would, that the existence of Santa Claus in reality is possible. But as a matter of fact, it happens that Santa Claus exists only in the understanding. Even though he could exist in reality, logically speaking, he doesn't. This sentence says that since that those two things in the complex antecedent are true about Santa Claus, then it's possible for something to be greater than Santa Claus, as Santa Claus happens to exist. Santa Claus exists, remember, only in the understanding. It's possible for something to be greater than that. What is the possibility? Well, it would be Santa Claus existing in reality as well. Okay, now, what does this complex sentence, which is what 3 says, what reason is there for believing that? Anselm expects that the atheist would agree to this one, just like the atheist should agree to the definition and to steps 1 and 2. Well, this sentence, this complex sentence, actually relies upon a deeper intuition, which Anselm expects everybody would agree to. The deeper intuition, in particular, is an ontological idea. Now, looking at the title of this, the alert reader will have noticed not only that this is a modern reconstruction of Anselm's argument for the existence of God, but that it's an ontological argument. Now, I trust that everyone has checked in their dictionaries what the meaning of the term ontological might be. What does the word mean? Well, it's got ology in its root, ontology. What is ology, or what does that suggest to you? The study of something. The study of aunts. It's like the spouse of your uncle. No, that's not spelled right. It's not true either. It's not the study of aunts. But it is the study of being or existence. Okay? Questions like, what is it for something to exist? What different kinds of modes of existence might there be? We've already seen differentiated in this argument existence in reality on the one hand and existence in the understanding on the other. But, I mean, things like characters like Sherlock Holmes and Superman, they exist in some way as fictional characters, perhaps, but they don't exist in reality. So discussions of this kind, you know, differentiating between different modes of existence, that's what ontology does. And what we have in line 3 is a proposition that claims to be making a general ontological statement about the relationship between existence in reality and existence in the understanding alone. It depends on yet a deeper principle. Now, this isn't equivalent, but here is a claim that is implicit in number 3 about the relationship between existence and reality and existence in the understanding alone. The idea is that existence and reality is greater than existence in the understanding alone. Now, this isn't the same thing as what's in line 3. We'll come back to line 3. But this is a general ontological principle that Anselm would claim, and I'm going to try and convince you, is just true of anything at all. Now, the word greater becomes important here, and now we've got to address that question that we left hanging earlier on. The word greater does not mean big. I'll just put, it's not big. We're not saying when we say that God is great that he's very, very large. That's not the point. Great does not refer to God's goodness either. We say that God is good. We talk about God's wisdom. God is omniscient. But neither of those things get at what is usually meant when it's said that God is great. The term great, by and large, indicates something about power, potency. And here we're not referring to, you know, muscles, not necessarily physical power. It's the more abstract power, which may or may not come down to physical consequences. The abstract power to accomplish things. God can do anything. God is omnipotent, all potent, all powerful. That's what is indicated when it's said that God is great. And that's why God's greatness is placed beside his wisdom and his goodness, or its wisdom is good and its goodness, however you want to say that. To say that in general, now we're not talking in this particular general ontological principle, we're not just referring to God here. This is about anything at all. You see, God is not referred to anywhere in it. For anything at all, existence in reality is greater than existence in the understanding alone. What's meant there? Well, when I learn as a kid that Santa Claus doesn't exist, I'm disappointed. Why am I disappointed? Well, because if my parents were to say, or if anybody, not just parents, but someone were to say to me, you know, well, you know, Santa Claus doesn't really exist, but it's perfectly all right for you to believe in Santa Claus. You can continue to believe in the idea, even though it has no reality. That's just not the same. Now, one's tempted to say, in that case, in the case of Santa Claus, that, well, it's not as good. It's not good enough. But remember, greatness here is not referred to good. That's not what we're talking about in this general ontological principle. We're talking about the reason why we would say that something exists only in the imagination, that it's a mere figment of thought. Why do we use those terms, only and mere? It reflects somehow the inferiority, in some dimension, of things that are only in the mind, only in the understanding, when compared to things that exist in reality. That's what this principle is supposed to get at. Now, it's not a question of goodness. Notice that if, let's say, think of something not like Santa Claus, but think of something like Dracula, something out of your own personal nightmares. When we wake up and find that the nightmare isn't real, we're relieved. I mean, far from it's being worse that it's only a dream, we're relieved that it's only a dream. It would be much worse if that dream were a reality. But again, it's still, there's an inferior, a lesserness of some kind, a lesserness of the dream, even in the case of Dracula or your nightmare figures. That's why we are relieved that the thing isn't real. In the case of stuff that's good, like Santa Claus, we would prefer it if it were real. In the case of things that are scary, we prefer that they're not real. So it's not goodness that's going on. It has to do with the potency. The reason that we're relieved is because once we realize that the dragons or Dracula or the nightmare characters aren't real, we realize that they can't do much harm. They can trouble us, but they can't do the kind of harm that they could do if they were real. And the reason that we don't like it when we find that something we had hoped for doesn't exist in reality, it's because even though we can still imagine it, imagining it isn't going to get us anywhere. It's not going to accomplish anything. So greatness is defined in terms of power or potency. Other than saying that, we have to remain somewhat vague about it. It's that very sense of greatness in which it's commonly said God is great, God is powerful. And that's also the sense that we use the word greater in the definition of God. God is that than which none greater is possible. We're talking about power and potency throughout. So the general ontological principle that we're getting at here that underlies Anselm's proposition number 3 is this one. Existence in reality is greater than existence in the understanding alone. So this number 3 actually embodies a substantive ontological claim about the relationship between existence in reality and existence in the understanding alone. And it says that existence in implies that existence in reality is greater than existence in the understanding alone, and draws number 3 as kind of a conclusion from that. Yep.
So is that saying like something that's actually, something that's in your mind can be better if, well not so much better, but greater if it's in reality, because then in reality it can like exercise its power and potency, and it's not, and in the mind it's only just a thought. Is that the kind of...
Well, that's right. That's what I've been saying is behind it. Okay. That's behind it. But if you figure out what you mean when you say, oh, that's just ideas, it's not real. Or in the other kinds of cases, whew, thank goodness it's not real. When you think of what it is that you mean when you have those reactions, then you'll understand what's being claimed here. But we're at a point now when it's time to do the proof. Because I'm going to take it that you're about as satisfied as I'm going to get you that the definition is correct and that 1, 2, and 3 are okay, unless I hear some final questions right now. Back then to the definition in our 3 propositions. We've agreed that God is that than which nothing greater is possible. Both the atheist and Anselm agree with this. Anselm would say that being than which none greater is possible exists in reality as well as in the understanding, but the atheist insists, no, this is just a figment of the imagination. This is like Santa Claus. He agrees with the definition, but disagrees that the thing defined exists. In number 1, the atheist and Anselm agree that God exists in the understanding at least, but Anselm says there's more. It's not just that God exists in the understanding, God exists also in reality. The atheist stands pat, says, no, I agree that God exists in the understanding, but that's it. That's the extent of it. God does not exist in reality. In number 2, both agree that the existence of God in reality is possible. In Anselm's case, he thinks it's not only possible, but actual. God also exists in reality. For the atheist, again, the fact, according to the atheist, is that God is just possible, merely possible, about as possible as, I'm told physicists tell us that there's a possibility, there's a remote possibility, but there's at least a non-zero possibility that at some point all the atoms in this room could collect up there in the corner, which would be a tremendous bummer for us, but there's at least a non-zero possibility of that. That's about as possible as the atheist is ready to concede the existence of God in reality. God exists in the mind. God is not contradictory. God, therefore, could, in principle, exist in reality too. But the fact of the matter is, according to the atheist, God doesn't exist in reality. God is only a possibility. And finally, line 3, both of them agree in the general principle that if the existence of something in reality is possible, but as a matter of fact that thing exists only in the understanding, then it's possible for something to be greater than that thing, namely the same thing existing in reality rather than only in the understanding. Now, Anselm says, let's take your opinion and see how far we can go with that. You say, what I've written out here in line 4. You say that as a matter of fact, God exists only in the understanding. Now let's just assume this for the sake of the argument. And let's go back to look at the sheet where we outlined the structure of this argument. We then can move from 4 to 5. If 4 were true, then it would be possible for something to be greater than God. How do we get there? Well, line 2 first. Line 2 we agreed on, the existence of God in reality is possible. Line 3 says, well, if the existence of something in reality is possible, line 2 says God, the existence of God in reality is possible. But, as a matter of fact, that thing exists only in the understanding. Well, line 4, which we are assuming for the sake of the argument, says that, as a matter of fact, God exists only in the understanding. Well, then it's possible for something to be greater than that thing. So, since part A and B of the antecedent are both satisfied in the case of God, we're entitled to conclude C. It's possible for something to be greater than God. And that's what we write in 5. If 4 were true, then it would be possible for something to be greater than God. And we got that by plugging 2 and 4 into 3. But then, in the move from 5 to 6, if 4 were true, it would be possible for something to be greater than that than which nothing greater is possible. All we do there is to substitute for the word God in 5, we substitute the definition, which we agreed to up here. So just plug that in. It would be possible for something to be greater than that than which nothing greater is possible. That's how we get to 6. If 4 were true, it would be possible for something to be greater than that than which nothing greater is possible. That comes from the definition and line 5. But that's a contradiction. It can't be possible for something to be greater than that than which nothing greater is possible. That's the conditional proof. That's the indirect proof. It shows that the supposition in line 4 leads to that contradiction. And in line 7, we're entitled to draw out the conclusion that's asserted there. The supposition that God exists only in the understanding, that's line 4, must therefore necessarily be false, since that assumption leads to the contradiction derived in line 6. That's an indirect proof from 4 through 6. So line 4 must be false. The atheist's view must be incorrect. Now that doesn't get us, that doesn't complete the proof for us. There's one more short step that completes the proof. Because we haven't used line 1 yet. Now let me just outline for you several possibilities for God. Okay? He could exist in the understanding. He could exist in reality. And then there are various combinations of those two things that we should list. Maybe he doesn't exist in either. This is just all the four logical possibilities in which these two things can be combined. Maybe he exists neither in the understanding nor in reality. Maybe he exists in reality, but he can't be comprehended. Maybe he exists in the understanding, but not in reality. And then finally, maybe he exists both. So these are, as you can see, these are just the four logical possibilities. Neither one, this one alone, this one alone, or both together. There aren't any other possibilities. Now the reason we have to take another step after line 7, if you look at it, line 7 says, the supposition that God exists only in the understanding must therefore be false. We can simplify that and say, God doesn't exist only in the understanding. That eliminates only one of the possibilities that we began with. That eliminates this. God exists only in the understanding. That's this one here. Let's number these. 1, 2, 3, and 4. Line 3 is the line that says that God exists only in the understanding. Do you see that? Okay. So that's the one we've eliminated in line 7. And you can look at that on your sheet. But that leaves three other possibilities. If we look at line 1, it says God exists in the understanding. We agreed all of us, the atheist included, we agreed with that line, and that line eliminates two of the other logical possibilities. Which ones? Right. Both of these say God doesn't exist in the understanding, so both of these are eliminated by line one, leaving only one remaining logical possibility, namely that God exists in the understanding as well as in reality, which proves what we set out to prove.